Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Kirsten Hostetler. I am ACRL Oregon President and Instruction and Outreach Librarian at Central Oregon Community College. I'm really excited to be here today because we have so many amazing, some might say excellent projects to hear about from our colleagues across the state. We have five presenters today who were all nominated for ACRL Oregon's Award for Excellence, which is our organization's effort to recognize exemplary projects that positively impact local communities, but also projects that can serve as an adaptable tool or resource for the broader library community. So we have a lot to hear about, a lot to share, and there should be times for questions as well. So we will jump right in with our first presenter. Sagan Wallace is from Oregon State University, and her project, according to her nominator, embraced the values of openness and sharing, and were quick to make the knowledge that they had gained readily available to others. So thank you so much, Sagan.
Hi, everyone. Like I said, I'm Sagan Wallace. I am the evening supervisor at Oregon State University, and you use they, them pronouns. And I just want to say thanks so much for letting me go first, because me give no time for my nerves to happen. I'm going to talk about our Alma Digital project for course reserves. Next slide, please. Before I can really get into it, I just want to say that this would not have been possible without some key players at my institution. Three names is here. Rima Reeves is our course reserve superstar, who just has years and years of experience with reserves and gave me the knowledge that I needed in order to be able to do some of this work. Steve Weber took care of all the wrangling of student workers to do scanning during the chaos that was 2020, and has continued to participate throughout. And then more recently, Jennifer Wells has joined our team, she is focusing directly on Alma Digital and is responsible for taking us from a 2020 like disaster and moving us into researching and implementing accessibility measures. And then just like, if I can express one thing that this project is all about, it's about the collaboration that's needed across a library. We really needed help with library administration, who really championed us with folks across campus, our library tech support, cataloging technical services, managing all of, like, the influx of new things we were purchasing, institutional legal counsel, who is willing to let us try this kind of new technology, campus student groups who connected us with the students who are actually in need of textbooks, and just so much more. I know I'm missing people. Next slide. So very quick rundown of what a timeline of this project was. I don't know if you remember 2020, but that was a decade-long year in which almost everyone's library shut down. Ours shut down right during finals week, and we had a huge student population who was depending on access to their textbooks from our course reserves program, and we needed to come up with something immediately. So that's what brings us into what I call like the box time. Box is basically Microsoft's answer to Google Drive. So it's just like a place where you can share different files with people. So we shared the crap out of them. We scanned everything we could get our hands on. We uploaded them into Box, and we shared those box links. We shared links to the box folders with people as they needed them. And we basically asked them nicely not to send the PDFs to anyone else. So we relied on the fact that it was a literal emergency to cover any copyright sins. It was extremely labor intensive because we had to create and share a box link for every single request we got. And it was in no way copyright compliant. So that brings us to the Alma Digital project that I worked on. I was trying to think as to this timeline, how I even like heard about Alma Digital, and that has completely left my brain, but somehow we stumbled upon the program. We're already using Alma through like Alma Primo with the Ex Libris ILS suite, and it's a kind of a module that you can use within it. And what it did, it kind of like fixed some of our issues. It let us restrict the number of viewers of the scanned course reserves to make it so that we were actually copyright compliant. It's integrated with our catalog so people could search for their books and find them themselves without having to have us, without having to have them know to ask us and without having us actually email them back with a link. And we could also connect it with our electronic course reserves organization so that people could look it up by their instructor name or things like that. And it gave us statistics, which are super helpful. And then there's like where this project is now. And I likened it to if you ever feel like you go into work and you're like a little bit sick, but you're like, I can push through today. And you like push through and finally like, okay, I'm just going home. I'm going to, you know, deal with it later. And you come back to work and you look at what past you did and you're like, wow, I was really out of it. That's what we're learning about some of these scans where we just did not have time or met the capacity to do everything the way we wanted to. So we definitely got it done. We did some incredible work, but we're finding our scans weren't consistent and a lot of our PDFs aren't accessible. And there's just like, you know, some patches that we're still figuring out. So that's what our next phase is all about, is fixing those things. Like I said, I was able to hire Jennifer Wells, and she's done a ton of research and work to figure out how to make our scans accessible and let us add new materials to our collection, as well as prioritizing fixing the old scans from the past 3 years. Next slide, please. I feel like I should at least tell you what is Alma Digital. On the user side, it's an online PDF viewer. It's not the fanciest, but it works. On the staff side, it's an institutional repository that allows you to limit the number of people who can view an item at any given time, meaning you can configure it in a way that adheres to controlled digital lending processes. We allow one viewer at a time for each book we have kept in a suppressed location. So like two copies of a book mean we can share two digital copies at a time and so on. So because we had, because it started as an institutional repository, we had to mess with it a bit to make it work for course reserves. Ex Libris has fortunately realized this is the future of their program. So they've actually instituted some stuff to make it work nicer, like have a wait list and a little bit more usable interface to it. I'm not going to go into the technical stuff, but if you have any questions about it, I'd be more than happy to go through and show you how to get it set up. Next slide. So finally, just wanted to share some pros and cons. The biggest pro is that it's really increased access to our books. We're able to supply course reserves to our eCampus students who were really limited to only licensed eBooks prior to this. Once a book's been uploaded, it's pretty minimal upkeep to keep it in the system. Students can find and read the books on their own. You can link to them in syllabi. And our usage has increased like dramatically, like to the point where I'm still trying to figure out if these numbers are correct. On the blue line, you can kind of see this, it goes up and down, but it wavers between about 100 views all the way up to over 1,200 views of one of our textbooks versus corresponding print checkouts, which really like went between like 1 and 30 in a month. So just like unreasonable usage. That said, I do want to be really clear about the different cons. It's a really heavy workload to create a digital book. It's hard to keep up during peak times. You can scan and upload quickly, but you can't make high quality accessible scans quickly. And there's so many quirks and pain points with Alma Digital. If any of you are Ex Libris consumers, you will know exactly what I'm talking about. So I'm really hoping it won't be the only product on the market for long. And I just whipped through that really quick because I want to leave time for questions. So next slide, I just wanted to open up to folks.
And feel free to drop questions into the chat and I can read them for Sagan. I had a quick question. Are there annotation tools for students when they're reading the PDF?
No, and I think that's one of the biggest complaints that we get about it. The other thing is, and this is related to accessibility, but even though it's screen reader accessible in a sense. It's really hard to copy paste from it because it'll try to strip out some of the tagging structure that would keep it looking right. So yeah, I would love for there to be annotations, but we don't have that functionality.
Can you print them?
We have it set that you can't print them. You can set up the system to allow people to print them out, but because we're uploading full books, you aren't allowed to do that with the controlled digital lending tenants.
Cool. It doesn't look like we have any other questions for you right now, but if we do have time at the end, we can do a big group question if you're still around. So thank you so much again for presenting today and also for your work on this project. Very cool.
Thanks, all.
So our next presenter is Kat Finney, my colleague at COCC and also my office neighbor. She's in the office behind me. and she was nominated for her work developing a vibrant and inclusive collection of children's literature benefiting not just COCC programs and students, but the larger Central Oregon community as well. So thank you, Kat.
I'm so glad to be here. Oh, let me try that again. I'm so glad to be here and thank you, Kirsten. So as Kirsten just mentioned, I'm with Barber Library, and one of my passion projects of the last, actually it's been 7 or 8 years now, has been our Children's Literature and Equity Resource Center. And I see the title of my talk, it's a little cut off, but it's Little Books, Big Ideas, Children's DEI Focused Literature in an Academic Library. And what I'm going to share is our delight in discovering how children's books can be a vital part of college level learning. And next slide. And I should say, I have a ton of slides, way too many. So I'm going to be rushing through many of these. We have a mission, of course. The most compelling part of this mission for me is that CLERC is a dynamic collection of equity-focused, resilience-building, and culturally responsive children's literature. Next slide. And also very, very fundamental to our work is the work of Dr. Sims Bishop, who has written quite a few pieces on the concept of thinking of children's literature as mirrors, windows, and sliding glass doors. So basically a child can see themselves in a picture book. Picture books can allow other people to look into other lives through windows, and sliding glass doors is kind of a dynamic in-between stage. Next slide. And before I realized that I had not near enough time to go through a lengthy timeline of how we came about, I put all this in here, but I'll just highlight a few of the items. We probably started 2015. In response to the need that our DEI director, Karen Roth at the time, and our ECE director, Early Childhood Ed director, Amy Howell, had for a curriculum that really focused on DEE content in the context of early learning, so children's books especially. Our library director, Tina Hovekamp, applied for a grant, and we got it in 2018. We doubled our collection, which up to then had been fairly small and rather elderly. And we ended up buying about 1,000 books in a summer. And since then we've had a grant almost every year, except for the COVID year. And with those grants, we've been able to include in our collection literacy kits, STEM kits, basically science kits, and musical instrument collections, as well as books covering all sorts of themes. Next slide. And I'm going to be a little self-indulgent here. There should be a little play button if you kind of, there you go, yeah. And can we hear this? Yeah, we go ahead and play it. And
along those lines, we started talking about what was the mission going to be of CLERC. Mm-hmm. And we really started talking about how we wanted it to be a place based on Dr. Rudine Sims Bishop's work around windows and mirrors and sliding glass doors, and the idea of representation, and inclusivity. And for our students who are studying to be educators and everyone else in the community to really see this as a space to find reflection, celebration of the diverse journeys of our community members and of humankind.
So I forgot to mention that that was Amy Howell, our director of ECE on campus, a colleague and a friend, and kind of one of the three mothers that put CLRC together, because we kind of think of ourselves as the parents of this, as this part of the library. So Amy just said it, right? Our purpose is to serve our community and, as she says, serve the world as well. Back to the idea of picture books as mirrors. Again, picture books can reflect your own experience, right? And they can also serve as windows to other kinds of lives, other communities' lives. And it doesn't have to be just the history. It can be the joy of camping, the joy of riding on your dad's motorcycle. Next slide. And in addition to mirrors and windows, we've developed a collection that also focuses on emotional learning and acceptance, primarily in response to feedback from our students and faculty and our community members. We really wanted children and students and staff, faculty and community to be able to encounter books about big life themes, The Dead Bird, for example, by Margaret Wise Brown, a beautiful book, or Emotional Literacy or Emotional Learning, Rabbit Listened is one of our favorite books in the collection, and or What It Is to Be Different and Be Accepted for Your Differences. Tacky the Penguin is a perfect example of that concept. And next slide. In addition to being a collection of children's books, we do a lot of things. Next slide. Of course, our key purpose is to serve our college community. We're using children's books as college-level teaching tools. And I know I hit on this a little bit already, but that middle rectangle can really bring home the concept. Children's literature brings felt experiences to academic concepts. And next slide, and I'll say a little bit more about that. So we have had classes from our nursing program, our EMS program, children's literature, early childhood education, language programs, and at the bottom there's English language learning as well. All of those programs use CLRC on a regular basis. What they're doing is using children's books to illustrate concepts or help students become deeply immersed in those concepts on a pretty personal, emotional, and reflective level. So if we go to the next slide, I can talk a little bit more about one program on campus, emergency medical services. They come into CLRC once a term for about 3.5 hours. And in that long session, they're working in pairs to explore picture books about scenarios and experiences that they might encounter in the field. So that means they're looking at books that feature narratives and stories of death, illness, accidents, crisis, big emotions. And they explore their own responses to the picture books as they read them. And they talk about how it might remind them of their own experiences or experiences they've seen in their families or their communities. And that in turn helps them think about the experiences of their current and future patients in the field. It's really been astounding to see these students interact with the book, share, and just have a deeper felt experience with content that might be much more dryly presented in a textbook. Next slide. Of course, we also serve the early learning community in Central Oregon and beyond, probably. We have a classroom space, which you can see on the little photo there in the corner, and that space is used for trainings. We have an advisory committee. We host meetings, parent groups. We have story times at least once a term. We have small collections. I mentioned it already, the children's instrument collection, our science kits, our literacy kits. All of these can be checked out by community members, preschool, early learning professionals, families, that kind of thing. And next slide. And of course, we serve families. And Kirsten might recognize some of these photos. We might recognize Kirsten. She so generously gave me some photos of her family enjoying CLRC this last weekend. And we have staff families, student families, and community families using this space. And next slide. And with CLRC, we are supporting COCC's principles of community and our institution's values of DEI. And next slide. We have a webpage. I'm going to skip going into that right now. It does feature a search form. We do have some online collections of children's books. Tumble Books is one of those. And some online book displays that we created during COVID. And next slide. And then in conclusion, we don't have to play those because it's going to probably just take too long. But I've been thinking about CLRC as this creative experience. And so you're working together, you're listening to your partners, your community and your communities, and you're responding and building something together. And that's what CLRC has been for us, I think, at Barber Library and for the campus and for my colleagues. And together we're creating something beautiful for our community and for the future. Thank you. I'm not sure I left time for questions. If I did, it's very brief.
That's okay. If anybody wants to ask a question of Kat, you can, again, drop that in the chat. And then if we do have time at the end, we'll do all the questions then, if that works for you, Kat.
Yeah, for sure.
Thank you so much. It's always lovely to see CLRC highlighted because I get to see it every day. So our next presenter is Rotunda Hawkins from Lindman Community College, and she is just going to be discussing a project that the nominator emphasized served as a great example of recognizing and responding to community needs, building lasting partnerships, and serving historically marginalized and underserved populations.
Hi, it's great to see everyone today. So I'm going to jump right in because I know we're a little short on time. And go ahead and go to the next slide. So in about 2015 or so, I was serving as the chair of our college's diversity council. And it came to my attention, we were changing our entrance exams for reading in particular was one of the areas. And it came to my attention that there was basically no services for folks who tested at a very low literacy level. And at one of our Lynn Library Consortium meetings, I asked the public libraries, what do you do when somebody says that they would like to increase their reading skills or they're looking for literacy tutoring? And they said, oh, we send them to you at LBCC. And I said, oh, Lordy, we do not have anything for them because the lowest level that we were serving was basically GED level classes, which start at fifth grade reading level. So we realized in these conversations that anybody who would be below a fifth grade reading level was not being served. And we did a little bit of investigating. I partnered up with Joyce Thompson Graham, who is the chair of our Adult Basic Skills Department. And we talked to the closest literacy programs, including the Mid-Valley Literacy Center in Kaiser, Oregon. And tried to figure out what kinds of things we could do. So as you can see, there's definitely a need. Benton County is one of the most educated places that there is, really. And you know, doing the math, that would still leave almost 7,000 people who are very, as it's described, lack basic prose literacy skills in our service district. Okay, let's go ahead and go to the next slide. So we talked about it, and these are the goals that were expressed in our LSTA grant that we wrote. It has sort of two prongs, basically serving the people who need to have their literacy increased, providing tutoring for those folks. But more importantly, one of the biggest needs we discovered in talking to various folks who were interested and who were providing tutoring was that they had tutors, they might have space for tutoring, they had volunteers, they had resources. But what they didn't have was an understanding of how to tutor very low literacy folks. any type of print resources that would help those folks. Ideas of how to work with folks that were that low literacy. So we were looking to also increase the capacity of our community partners that were going to be in this partnership and to have resources available for them for the tutoring. So go ahead and go to the next slide. Our initial partners that we were really talking with were the libraries and the Lynn Libraries Consortium, which was created with a different LSTA grant in 2012. And the GED network that was here then. So these were all the places that were doing GED tutoring. Some of them, community spaces, churches, those kinds of things. That GED network has since gone defunct. So we've just partnered with some of the institutions that were in that network. We applied for the grant in 2019, and we have grown now to have 13 community partners and 18 tutoring locations. Go ahead and go to the next slide. So what we did was in year one, we hired a coordinator, and the coordinator's job was to help us create the structure for a long-lasting community literacy program that would be sustainable after the grant expired and that person's job would no longer be funded. And so they created the structure. I helped them gather all sorts of resources. They created a tutor training sort of curriculum and structure, resources for tutors. And then I put together these literacy kits that I'll talk a little bit more about, but literacy kits for adults. So I heard somebody mention literacy kits in their children's collection. Also a supplemental collection of learning resources for both the tutors and for the students. We also have a very large collection of graded readers. And since COVID, we also check out laptops and hotspots to folks who are doing tutoring or getting tutored. Go ahead and go to the next slide. Here's a picture of our literacy kit. So let me just describe these kits. This was an idea that we had for making it really easy for somebody who tutors or somebody who's being tutored to have all of the resources that are of an appropriate level at their fingertips. So this is a kit level two. So it's at about second grade reading level. And we mainly use in these kits resources from New Readers Press. So New Readers Press, thankfully, their focus is on adult literacy, and they do the leveling for you. So they'll say, these are the resources for about second grade reading level. They have three main literacy sort of lines. What you can see there is the Laubach Way to Reading, the Challenger Series, and the Journey to Success. So we bought all of their materials using the grant. And then we also included the Teacher's Guide is in there, and a few graded readers that are of an appropriate level. So we bought a bunch of these and put them all together, and they are at the partner libraries that could fit them on the shelf. And then we keep any extras here at LBCC. So I'll have you go to the next slide. So as I mentioned, we didn't get off the ground. 2019 is when the grant started, and we didn't start tutoring till almost 2020. It was, you know, late fall 2019. You all know what happened in 2020. That threw us for a big loop because all of our tutoring was happening face to face. So it took us a little while to figure out getting laptops to everybody. We didn't have the laptops at first, so we were just checking out the student laptops that are for our students here at LBCC to people, etc. But anyhow, we have served at least 25 students. I totally forgot to mention that in year two, what we did was we decided to expand the grant to Spanish speakers, people whose native language is Spanish and who are learning to read in Spanish. So we recruited bilingual tutors, and 10% of our tutors are now bilingual and able to tutor in Spanish. And we have tutored, I want to say, a total of seven Spanish speakers. It's right on the slide. We're currently tutoring one Spanish speaker and six other students. So I'll have you go to the next slide. The organizational structure that we created, now the grant funds have run out, the grant is over. And so what we have is an all volunteer run community organization-based program. And so we have a steering committee that I'm on. There are some co-chairs of the steering committee that include our ABS, Adult Basic Skills, that is, department chair is also one of the co-chairs. We have a tutoring coordinator. That person is in charge of training the tutors and being a support person for them, a partnering coordinator. So they're our primary contact for the folks seeking literacy tutoring, a webmaster, and librarian liaisons who are in charge of all of our collections at the various institutions. Okay, go ahead and go to the next slide. So the challenges we ran into, of course, I already mentioned, 2020 and the COVID-19 pandemic, some students unable to benefit from tutoring. So to just say a little bit more about that, there's good reasons that folks are low literacy as adults, and some of those reasons don't go away. And so there are folks with print and intellectual disabilities that have real trouble learning how to read. And we don't have the capacity to get them tested. That's something that is really difficult to do, to get them diagnosed. And a lot of our tutors, luckily, some of our tutors are former literacy specialists, like elementary school literacy specialists who know a lot about this, and that's helpful. But then we also have had folks who came to us for tutoring who were, you know, actively using heroin, you know, problems like that, where it just wasn't going to work for them to progress. Acquiring, leveling, and cataloging materials in Spanish was an enormous challenge. And so we mainly used free materials available from the Mexican government. My plan was to go to the book fair in Guadalajara, as I usually would do, but it wasn't happening during the pandemic. And then also, you know, some of our partners, people's priorities change and folks come and go. Okay, next slide. I just like to highlight Noah. He's agreed to have his story be told. Noah was raised Amish, and so his education ended really young. And so he came to us reading at about the third grade level and was struggling to complete GED classes. And so he got tutored. He brought his literacy level up. He completed his GED. He's now a physics major, and he's got a 3.6 GPA here at LBCC. next slide. All right, so this is a link to our website. We have a fantastic website that is being updated by volunteers. I hope you'll check it out. It also links to catalog records of our literacy kits, if you're curious about what's in there, the free resources that are available from the Mexican government. And then the next slide has my contact information as well. Thanks.
Thank you so much. And again, questions, drop them in the chat that hopefully we can address at the end. Thank you so much. That was awesome to hear about. So our next presenter is Sarah Walston from Eastern Oregon University, who was nominated for her work developing an innovative project that addressed digital equity in a rural environment.
Thank you. As Kirsten said, I'm Sarah Ralston from Eastern Oregon University Library, and my project is the EOU Library Mobile Virtual Reality Lab. Go to the next slide, please, Tamara. Thank you. The idea for this was not an original one. There were a couple of serendipitous events that sparked the idea for this project. First, I had happened upon the article Beyond the Lab, Virtual Reality for Undergraduate Anatomy and Physiology Students in the spring of 2021. And second, that same week, my director announced that the State Library was accepting proposals for American Rescue Plan Act and LSTA grants. So we received about $18,000 in grant funding to purchase equipment, accessories, and software. And I was able to essentially emulate this project, which came from Penn State Hazleton. They had already tested headsets and software for virtual dissection for their anatomy and physiology class. And I was able to use their recommendations and select ShareCareU VR for my collaboration with EOU's A&P class. The software, ShareCareU VR, allows users to view and move and manipulate organs of the human body in a completely immersive way. So say you're looking at the heart, for example, you can virtually grab it and turn it around and move it and zoom in using the VR controllers. You can look at dissected views. You can speed up the beats per minute of the heart, look at various disease states or pathologies. For example, you can look at the heart in AFib or cardiac arrest, and you can virtually go inside the organ. And when I say that it's immersive, it's beyond just being in 3D. So when you have a headset on, it appears like you're actually inside the heart. So you can look up and down and behind you and all around, and it seems like you're surrounded by a heart chamber. You can see it moving, beating, opening and closing, blood flowing, and so on. You can also go inside other organs, including the stomach and the eye and the large intestine, which is basically like traveling through the colon from the point of view of a colonoscopy scope, which isn't as gross as it sounds. It's actually really cool. Next slide, please. In order to run the ShareCareU software and accommodate our human anatomy and physiology class, we got 4 Alienware laptops, which are high-end gaming PCs that are capable of running VR. And we got 4 HP G2 Reverb Windows Mixed Reality headsets, and then 4 licenses of ShareCareU. We also got 2 MetaQuest headsets, which are all in one, so they don't require the use of an additional computer in order to view VR. And then we got 1 Oculus Rift S. Next slide, please. In order to serve the A&P students, we converted the office next door to mine to a VR studio where we can have a permanently installed VR setup so that we don't have to unbox everything and set it up every time somebody uses it. That class has 85 to 100 students in any given term, so we can't really take the tech to them. Instead, we have an appointment system and they come to the library. It's another great way of getting students into the library who might not otherwise come. And we have the capacity to run 4 appointments at the same time by using study rooms that we've converted for this purpose. Next slide. So this is Dr. Mortimer, who is a history professor, and his student London, and they're both doing the Civil War battlefield experience in our VR studio. Dr. Mortimer is using the HP headset and the laptop, so we're able to see what he's seeing on the TV monitor. And this enables students to work in groups, especially for that A&P class. They come in usually in groups of 3 or 4. London is doing the same app, but in one of the MetaQuest headsets. We normally wouldn't have 2 people in the room at the same time because you need room to move around and not crash into each other. You can't see the room around you when you're wearing a headset, but they were testing it out for a class and posing for me to take pictures for presentations. Next slide, please. Most of the use that we've had has been from biology and health and human performance, so our exercise science and biomechanics classes, as well as history. But we've been seeking out and developing other campus partnerships as well. Next slide. The picture on the right here shows a collaboration that we did with the Office of Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Belonging for Black History Month last year. So we set up an installation of this civil rights era history app called I Am a Man in the student union, which gets a lot more traffic than the library. And so students walking by could stop and use it. And we had the student workers that staff this area kind of running things. So that was great. We got a lot of use. It got the word out in a way that we couldn't do quite as well if we had just kept things inside the library. On the left, this represents a collaboration with one of the RAs who was doing a de-stress event in the residence hall and asked for us to bring over some VR equipment. So we have one student who's playing Fallout 4, which is kind of a nuclear Fallout zombie apocalypse kind of game. And then another student with the MetaQuest, the white headset on, who's doing the Anne Frank House experience. Next slide. This is a student-run research project in exercise science where they have a bike trainer that's connected to a VR app called VZ Fit. The student is actually riding a course around the Great Salt Lake, and the bike trainer actually adjusts for changes in elevation and things like that. The rider actually sees the course through the headset. It's kind of like Google Street View. And then the research students are measuring his oxygen intake, his wattage or output, and his heart rate. They also have the student ride the course without VR and take the same measurements, and then they use that for a comparison. And what they're finding is that the research subjects say that riding in VR is easier and more fun, but they're actually showing that they're working harder. So they have higher heart rates, higher oxygen intake, and higher output when they're riding in VR. So that was a really cool initial finding, and I'm looking forward to seeing these students present their research findings at our spring symposium in a couple of months. Next slide. So this took a lot of logistics to set up and a lot of partnerships, and I won't go into all of the details here, but if anybody is interested in this type of project and wants to follow up with me, I'll share my email address and I'm happy to talk about it. I'm also going to be doing a presentation at OLA. So if anybody's attending OLA and if you're interested in virtual reality, I really invite you to stop by. I'm going to bring a couple of kits with me, so you'll have an opportunity to try it out for yourself if you like. Next slide. And I just want to make sure that I take a moment to thank the State Library for that grant that really made it possible, as well as, you know, getting buy-in from all of my faculty and staff here at my library, as well as our IT department, who've been really essential in partnering. Next slide. So there's my email address. And I think there's probably not time for questions, but maybe we can take them at the end. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, if there are any questions for Sarah, put them in the chat, and I hope we have time. So thank you very much for that. And our final presenter today is Tracy Trait from Reed College, who, according to the nominator, prioritized a people-first approach to the collection and care of archival materials that empowered people to use the past to speculate on or create through direct action radical, liberatory, and inclusive futures for us all. So Tracy, thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm gonna just take a moment and share my screen. Second. Okay, I'm not sharing the right, give me 1 second. Okay, here we go. So, radically reimagining the archival process, a series with the Blackavis. You might be, so first let me introduce myself. My name is Tracy Drake. I'm currently the Director of Special Collections and Archives at Reed College, where I've been here since 2019. And when I first got here, it was like the pandemic happened like 6 months later, but I was from Chicago. And so I was a part of this group of archivists, the Blackavists, who were doing work in the community. And I knew that I wanted to establish some of that work here in Oregon as I transitioned to Portland. But I didn't really have any established connections or ties to the community. And the pandemic only worsened that, right? And so when I was in Chicago in 2018, the Blackavis was this group of like six Black archivists. We believed in like open access, preserving Black history and material. So all of us were from Chicago, the Chicago area. We also understood and knew that a lot of like Black history and culture wasn't being preserved. And so we also understood that it was kind of very unique that six Black archivists were in the same place at the same time. Knowing how and understanding like the pervasive whiteness, right, in libraries and archives and museums. So with that goal and understanding and mission and value of wanting to preserve and archive the collections, prioritizing the collections of like Black folks, because we were all Black. I wanted to do some of that work here in Portland. So we started in Chicago. We were working with a lot of artists because what we understood is that artists, whether that's visual artists, folks who are in music, paint, art, when folks come into the archives, we get a lot of questions about there's this really great artist and I have this name, but I can't find any information on them. And what we know is this is that folks were everywhere, but then they seem to disappear. And so once the pandemic had kind of settled a little in April of 2020, we decided that we wanted to do, I wanted to do programming with BIPOC and queer artists in Chicago, I mean, in Portland, I'm sorry. Portland has a huge history of artists in Portland. And so I wanted to take that knowledge and help them to preserve their materials. So what we would do is, one, our outreach would start within the Reed community, and then it would extend outward to the Portland BIPOC artist workshops. So the first day, we did 3 days of events. The first thing that we did was we went into, when the Black events got to Portland, we came into classes and started talking to students about what that looks like, the importance of preserving the historical material across campus. Because what I also know is that it was important that I'm only one person. And so I believe in archiving as a collaborative process. And so the way my approach to that is to tell, I need the entire community at Reed to help me to archive this material and to think about like how folks want to be remembered. We had for years done a very good job here at Reed at preserving the history of dead white men, but we had done a really poor job of preserving the histories of the multicultural students and BIPOC LGBTQ folks here on campus. And so I thought it was really important that we start to have a conversation. And so after we went to the classes, we decided to have a panel discussion where the Black Avists talked about a current project that we were working on where we had collaborated with artists in Chicago. And we had just won a Mellon Foundation grant for $300,000 to help assist us in that work of preserving the stories and narratives of people of color in Chicago. And so we want to talk about that work to help inspire action and conversations around the ways in which we wanted to remember those stories here because that history was so important. And then on the second day, April 15th, we had a kitchen table conversation. So I always wanted to keep this a very relaxed environment. And so with the kitchen table conversations, it was relaxed in that we had a student come in and the student came in and was facilitated a conversation with the Blackavists. So they had some pre-prepared questions about how we do that work, how we engage as students, how we carry on, how they carry on that legacy, how we start to do the work of preserving the history of BIPOC folks and LGBTQ folks at Reed College. And then as we were having this conversation, we were also engaged in like a zine making workshop. So we had all of these materials on the table for zine making. And then, which comes up later, and there was also a photographer who was taking pictures throughout the 3 days of the event. And then the last day, after reaching inward, we invited about 50 Portland artists to, they were LGBTQ folks, BIPOC folks, to Reed College. And the Black Avis held a series of workshops with each of the individual, with the group of artists. So one of the complications of that, it was still COVID. So of the 50 we invited, 25 actually registered and confirmed. But then the day before, some folks got sick. And so we had to take precautionary measures. So that day we ended up with anywhere between 12 to 15 individuals who actually attended the sessions. Some folks left at different parts of the day because it was a whole day event. So it went from 9 a.m. until 2 o'clock that afternoon. And so some of the sessions that the Black Avis held with the group were archiving 101, digital preservation, social media is not an archive. And then there was archiving, activating the archives and finding what you need. So as artists, we also know that they use they are also researchers as well. And so they utilize the archives to inspire their work. And so we wanted to help help them to understand how that process works and what it looks like to be in the archive. And then we, as the day went on, we were also making zines. We also, I raised funds so that we could actually pay each artist. So each artist that attended the workshops was paid. It wasn't a whole lot, but it was a nominal fee of $100. But I wanted to ensure, because I understood that time is a big investment. And so I wanted to make sure that we were giving folks money for their time that they were spent to us. So not only were they getting this knowledge, but they were also getting some monetary compensation that was mailed out to them after the event. I thought it was both an enriching experience. I learned a lot, and we built a lot of connections through the community, some of which have actually stayed really strong. And we didn't actually really have any connections to the community both a library and a campus outside of these programs. So some of these folks I'm still constantly working with, and then I get invited to different things, which I feel like is important. And it was the start of a conversation, because I also realized is that there weren't any really Black only cultural heritage institutions in Portland. And so that also got me to thinking about what does that actually mean for the survival of the materials that is created by the Black community here. And I think those are some serious conversations that we should have. And some of that conversation was actually had that day. And so I thought it was an important start to a much larger plan moving forward. And so this is a group, this is one of the silly group pictures of some of the community members from that day. We talked about very tough topics, but we also had fun. So it was lighthearted too. I don't want you to think that was all serious. we made a scene together. And then this is the output of the scene at the end of the program. And everybody got shipped one.
And Patty Melts and Monte Carlos and El Dorado. So I'm waking up out of my slumber feeling like Rollo. So follow.
So the zine kind of documents the experience that we had together, the fun of it all, but also the seriousness of what we were able to do together. And finally, I just want to leave you with this quote, because I think that for me, it personifies like everything that I intended to happen that weekend. And I keep saying I, but it was a ton of people that helped. This was a really big event. And so there are nameless names that I could mention, but we don't have the time. But I wanted to leave because we, as faculty, staff, students, and community members of Portland, Portland's BIPOC community, we all came together. And this is how I feel like we need to all have a stake in how we understand our past, to feel ownership of the project and to excavate our collective memories and share what we discover. How we understand our past shapes what we can imagine for our future. So.
Thank you so much, Tracy. That was a great quote to end on. Does anybody, so we have, and it was perfect timing, we have a couple minutes left. Does anybody have any questions for Tracy or any of the other presenters that you weren't able to ask? There was some back, Kat was able to address a question that was presented in the chat, but anybody else? You can also unmute yourself. You don't have to type up the question. The thing where I count in my head, try to give the Zoom silence.
I'm just putting my email in the chat because I didn't have it on one of my slides. I know it's going to be recorded. Plus my website where the PowerPoint lives.
Perfect. Thanks, Kat. So yeah, thank you so much everyone for showing up today and for sharing these projects. We will be hosting a few more webinars this year, so keep an eye out for announcements about those. We're also opening up board nominations pretty soon. It should be in April. So if you're interested in being more involved in ACRL Oregon, keep an eye out for that and feel free to reach out to me directly or any of the current board members if you want to chat about what the positions are, what the expectations and responsibilities and that kind of thing is. We are happy to share. Someone mentioned OLA. If anyone's going to be in OLA in Bend, which is where Kat and I are located, we're probably going to do a little ACRL social. So keep an eye out for information on that. Thank you all so much. It was so amazing to learn about all of your great work that you guys have been doing. And yeah, I look forward to seeing you in other webinars, other events.
Thanks, everyone. See you later.
Thank you.